So as we continue our series, it's actually a personal pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker that you all know is Dr. Louise Montello, quite a visionary in the field of music therapy, so I have a bias for loving what she does. But she's a visionary not just for the program here, but I think in terms of integrating music into wellness from infant through end of life. Her book, Essential Music Intelligence, is used throughout the coursework here, and it gives you insight into her philosophy, but nothing like the live presentation you're going to get tonight. So it's a real pleasure to welcome Louise Montello.
Thank you so much. Well, it's great to be here and to talk to you about a topic that's, I don't know, do I need this mic as well as this one? Okay. To talk to you about a topic that is really close to my heart, which is how music therapy can be used to help people that are suffering with PTSD or other kinds of trauma-related disorders. And I'll tell you briefly about my background and why this topic interests me. First of all, because as a creative arts therapist, almost everyone that we are going to work with has been traumatized in some way. Having a handicap can be traumatizing. Having abuse, childhood abuse, is traumatizing. Being abandoned, being neglected, having mental illness, all of these things are associated with trauma. And often, one of the major underlying issues of people with traumatic illnesses is that there are no words to describe what is going on inside, particularly with early trauma that has happened to us before we were able to speak. There literally are no words. Trauma gets processed from the first 3 years of our lives through the body and through image, through the senses. And so there is no cognition around what has happened to us. And in that way, many people are trapped in their trauma memories for their whole lives. They've been in verbal therapy for years and years and years, and they know exactly what's wrong with them from a verbal perspective. But the body hasn't been able to communicate. And that's one thing that music is so powerful in being able to work directly from the body, particularly with singing, with improvisation. All of those memories and the emotions associated with those memories are trapped in the body. And in a very innocent and sometimes playful way, music therapy engages the body and allows those suppressed memories and feelings to be released and explored and transformed. And that's really, to me, one of the most powerful things about music therapy, is that not only does it allow us to gain knowledge into the body and into our emotional lives, but it gives us the power to transform that is destroying our life force and our sense of joy and ability to live our lives to the fullest. And so the question is, how does music do that, right? Just think about it yourselves. How has music transformed your own lives, right? Does anybody want to share? Think of a time when a song or singing something or whistling or writing something has changed your life in some way.
Well, for me, music in particular taught me a new language.
Should I stand near you so my mic can hear you? Oh, you got it. Okay.
Yeah. For me, music taught me a new language. I was part of, when I returned back to the, from the Dominican Republic to this country, I was involved in an ESL program where they used music to teach English to students that were Spanish language speakers. So one of the first songs that I learned was Stevie Wonder, I Just Called to Say I Love You. And I was just so into that song, I don't know why, but it was just, the, I guess, the introduction to the culture, the music, learning how to speak and just feeling confident and being able to sing this song. It just, it was very empowering being in that program and learning, you know, through music.
Yeah, songs have a meaning that sometimes is really hard for us to say in words, you know? And here you are, an immigrant, and you don't really know this culture very well, and you're singing a song about not being alone, you know, and expressing love, and what could make someone feel more at home than something like that. So that's a really good example. So what I want to do today is talk about what are the signs and symptoms of post-traumatic stress disorder, and also the term complex trauma. How many of you are aware of that term and what it means? There's been so much research done on post-traumatic stress disorder over the last 20 years, and what we're finding is that not everybody who goes through trauma, like war or accidents or some kind of experience of rape or violence, not everyone gets post-traumatic stress disorder. And one of the things that scientists are finding is that people with complex trauma, people that grew up around trauma, are much more susceptible to post-traumatic stress disorder because the foundation of their personality is really shaky. You know, there's fragmentation that happens early on in the psyche when we grow up in an environment that is emotionally unstable, that is violent, where there is abandonment and neglect. And those issues really point to the word attachment. You know, young people who are in this kind of complex trauma environment don't really trust. They don't feel safe because they're in environments where there's inconsistent parenting, there's unstable emotional adults in their lives that often fly off the handle and they yell and they, you know, they hit or they do other kinds of abusive behaviors. So imagine a little child who's just beginning to feel their way in the environment and have this kind of behavior going on around them. The sense of safety and trust never gets established. So what do you think happens to young people like this? What are some of the consequences of this kind of violent, unstable environment?
I'm sure some of them either react to situations like their parents did because that's all they know, and it might just be like a reflex, or they might just be like socially awkward and maybe not know what some of the social norms are.
Yeah, we basically take in what the environment offers us, right? We don't have the ego strength to say, well, that behavior isn't right. Or I want a mommy who doesn't go away and leave me alone. A child doesn't know how to say that. Anything else?
They might kind of form some sort of shell to protect themselves, even if they get into an environment that's healthier than their previous one. They might have trouble like getting over a trust, you know, issue and being able to form more meaningful relationships. It's sort of a social awkwardness, but like to a like higher degree where they just can't form functioning relationships well because they haven't ever learned, like, they all they've learned is that, like, you can't trust someone, you can't ever feel safe. So they just kind of, like, close in on themselves.
That's a good point. Winnicott, who is a psychoanalytic writer who has worked a lot with creativity and his work with children, would call it a false self. You know, we create this persona that makes us feel safe in that we do everything that other people want us to do for them. And we hide our real thoughts and our real feelings and our real needs, because it's not safe to let those things be known, because they could be, we could be shamed, we could be abused, we could be ignored, we could be gotten rid of, or whatever. And so that's something that we see a lot in young people.
Could they create some kind of a fantasy life and live within themselves in a fantasy?
Sure, I've seen that in my own clients. I had a woman that, such a sad story. She grew up, she and her sister, living in the back seat of a car. Her mother was a jazz singer who, you know, got sporadic gigs and really never made enough money to afford a place to live. So she literally lived in a car, and her mother would go off to rehearsals, and the two little kids, one was 3, one was 5, would literally go to a supermarket by themselves and steal their food. So this woman had this very rich fantasy life of these little people that loved her, and she had hierarchies, almost like Gulliver's Travels in a way. It was very, very rich. And it was her way of creating a safe environment for herself. And in fact, while we're on this topic, Melanie Klein, who's another psychoanalytic theorist, talks about reparation through creativity. That when we grow up in situations where there's harming that goes on, or thoughts about, you know, destructive thoughts or whatever, children counteract that by actually making things and offering them as gifts. So she actually believes that one of the rationales for being creative is this reparation through creativity, that if we didn't have anything that was broken, we probably wouldn't create very much. Isn't that interesting? I don't know if that's true. I mean, many of the artists and musicians that I know seem to come from very intact, stable families. But then again, that's what they say. I mean, sometimes we don't remember the stuff that happens to us as children. Question, comment?
Well, I guess it's a complex question, but what is the relationship between shame, trauma, and attachment styles, adult attachment styles?
Shame, trauma, and adult attachment styles. Well,
those are different theoretical frameworks.
You know, shame is always something that is destructive. You know, we shame somebody, it makes us feel like there's something wrong with us. And when we feel like there's something wrong with us, it's difficult to attach, right? We're afraid that person's going to find out that there's something wrong with us, and so we might as well just hide, you know, or pretend that we like everybody and everyone should like us because we're a good person. But that's not attachment. That's a kind of this false self reality that I think a lot of people who've had shame tend to find safety. In fact, Beethoven did. Beethoven grew up in an abusive family. His father was very violent, and his mother, according to him, was very saintly. And he was very ashamed of his father, and he was shamed by his father. And so he pretended that he came from a noble family. And he literally told everybody as he started to become more well known that, you know, he was from this more, you know, noble family, and that, you know, he felt good about himself. But you could see underlying that kind of false reality was the suffering that he went through with not being accepted for who he was, and being shamed and being hit. And I mean, anytime you hit somebody, anytime you're violent, that's shaming somebody. That's saying, you know, there's something wrong with you. And a kid can never figure that out. Kid will say, well, what did I do? I didn't do anything. Why are you hurting me? So, and so the shame is something that you can never figure out, because it's always wrong. Yeah, of course.
I keep envisioning your question about the children, how are children affected, but basic needs being met, basic needs of love, food, shelter, comfort. And if those basic needs aren't met, then it sets in motion a whole series of maladaptive responses, right? Hoarding, aggression, lack of attachment, those are all healthy. Attachment is a healthy thing that can't occur.
Yeah.
As you said, it's not just a foundation. Does that compute?
Absolutely. And relating that to complex trauma, if a child doesn't attach because their basic needs haven't been met, then that just perpetuates this feeling of not having enough or not having anything that they need. And it creates this sort of hunger inside, which we find in a lot of people with addictions and that kind of thing, which often can be traced back to some kind of trauma in the family or abandonment or neglect. So, but music therapy, one of the most exciting things right now, and we're going to actually get into doing some music therapy here in a couple of minutes, but one of the most exciting things right now is the idea of a music therapy stimulating the release of neurotransmitters that are, quote, feel-good hormones that can actually start repairing some of the overwhelming negative sorts of or life in de-hancing, if that's a word, life destroying kinds of hormones that are released in the body, like cortisol and some other norepinephrine, things like that, that can actually have a negative effect on the tissues of the body. But one of the things that particularly in a music therapy context, it's not just that music is healing people, it's the relationship that we develop with the clients. And the music being sort of, I like to see it kind of as a triangle. I think Mary talked about this last week, that there's the patient, there's the therapist, and there's the art form that work together in creating a healing solution to some of the issues that we grapple with. So within that relationship, particularly when we're playing with the client, we are releasing the hormone called oxytocin. How many of you are familiar with what oxytocin is? Have you heard that word before? Yeah, so oxytocin is the hormone that's actually released when the baby is about to be born. It releases oxytocin in the womb to help to lessen the pain so that the mother can deliver without, you know, just being torn apart inside. And it's also the emotion, the hormone that's released when the mother is rocking and feeding the baby, and the baby is cooing and lolling to the mother's love, mother's touch. And it's interesting, I was just reading something about autistic children and how they, a lot of them have a deficit in oxytocin. And so they're born not connecting with other people. And the births that many women have had when they've had autistic children have been extremely difficult. So it's so interesting to me. I have an autistic nephew, and as a music therapist, I'm always using music, but when he was a little boy, I would hold him on my lap at the piano, and I would sing and play with him. And in those moments where I was connecting in that way, he became normal. He could speak, he could, you know, he could give affection, And I do that with him today as well. He's 13, and I still see how there's something about the intimacy that comes with the musical relationship that feeds the autistic child and brings them back to this sense of normalcy. So, but in terms of trauma, that kind of intimacy is very rare, particularly in people with complex trauma, the kind of intimacy that we all crave, we've been deprived of. And so we, in fact, we're afraid of it. Because if someone comes too close, it could remind us of when we were traumatized in some way. And so in music therapy, the music, again, is the intermediary. So you're not exactly touching the person. The music is touching them. And that's how you start to repair those kind of early attachment deficits in a way that's safe for the patient. You're not forcing your way into their lives and re-traumatizing them. The music is taking care of them. Yes.
I've heard this term before, I don't know if it's still used or even relevant, this trauma triangle, like perpetrator, victim, rescuer. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering, it sounded almost like what you were saying is a possibility of breaking that cycle by allowing an object that's not a
person. It's not a person.
Not a person.
And people can be very threatening. I know I work with a lot of traumatized people in my private practice, and what I often hear from them is, I love dogs more than I love people. Or I love my pets, I love my cats, because people are not, they are not safe. And so a dog is not a person, or a cat is not a person. Music is not a person. Other art forms are not people. And in that way, they can be safer in healing people with trauma. Any other questions so far before I move on to some of the theory and the practices that I use in this work? Okay, good. So how many of you are familiar with the causes and the symptoms of trauma? I don't have to really go through that. A lot of people see these things and they think, oh my God, I have a lot of those. Well, the fact is, a lot of us have, been traumatized. Just take a look at some of these things. Narcissistic defense, we talked about, the false self. Schizoid symptoms, pane of glass, you can't get too close to me. That's a schizoidal sort of thing. Borderline symptoms, so that's a big, topic these days in psychology, borderline personality, and it's been such a horrible stigma over the years, but now we're realizing it's just something that's often very much related to unresolved trauma, anything else on this list that you want to comment on? Criminal behavior. If you've had all these deficits in your life, then you feel like you need to get more. And sometimes we can't get more unless we engage in criminal behavior.
The fragmentation, what exactly was switching from the state?
Yeah, that's a really good question. That's one of the hallmarks of post-traumatic stress disorder. When we have trauma, particularly at an early age, or something that's so horrific we cannot take it in, the ego becomes fragmented. And so pieces of the trauma are kind of located in different parts of the psyche. If we took it all in whole, we would just explode. So that creates kind of what we call subpersonalities. There's your core self, and then there's the wounded inner child. There's the perfect inner child. There's the perpetrator. Often, when you've been abused, you identify with the aggressor in order to survive, and so you have an aggressor inside of you. It's not who you are, but it's a kind of sub-personality. It's a way to cope with the horror that you experienced within. What are some other sub-personalities? There's, I write about this in my book, there are sub-personalities at different stages of your development. There can be a baby sub-personality. Do you ever, I mean, you might even have this in your own life, where you just, sometimes you just feel like a baby and you just want to sleep. You want to curl up in a fetal position because you cannot cope. You know, there's something in your life that you don't have the ego skills to deal with, right? There's a raging teen. Do you ever see that part of yourself? You know, here we are adults, but we still, you know, really, we put on our teenage music, we play it really loud, and we're like going like this, and, you know, it's like, I need that. That's a part of me. But again, like I said, it's not your core. They're just parts of yourself that weren't integrated because you didn't have the help that you needed to process the horror and the feelings associated with that. Does that answer your question?
I'm just wondering where that crosses the line between what you just described about wanting to listen to your music or curl up, like we all do that, right? Between that and what manifests when fragmentation is an issue. What's the difference in the definition?
Well, if you get stuck in those self states, you know, if they get in the way of your functioning, you know, with a healthy ego, you know, knows how to bring themselves back, an intact ego. But if you have fragmentation, often, you know, you'll be stuck in that little baby state for weeks. And I have clients like that. They can't get out of bed. They can't. And so you really have to work with these individual self states to get them all on the same page and to teach them coping skills, you know, and that they never had.
I'm interested in the therapeutic technique of mentalization. I know that, like, at least none of these directly say it, but the inability to not have a theory of mind of what other people are. Obviously, that's true in autism, but I think also in some PTSD situations, you know, like inability to put yourself in the mind of the question I was wondering, I know a lot of the mentalization therapy is two people in a room talking, is that what you meant? Is it what hurt? You know, but can you do that as an option, like music?
Very much so, and I'll show you examples of how that's done. Another thing, another hallmark of PTSD is dissociation, which is where we are, you ever see people and they just blank out? And you're like, hello, where are you? That's how we cope with really severe trauma often, is that we sort of leave our bodies. We're not there. And that's a really good thing to do, you know? If you're in a horrible accident and you're just sort of watching yourself, or you're, you know, being attacked in some way, you know, you're sort of you're coping in a way that you're not really feeling the full impact of the pain. But unfortunately, in order to heal dissociation, you will eventually have to go through the memory of whatever it is that created that dissociation. But you'll be in an environment that's safe, and that will. And you'll do it in very baby, small baby steps. It's not like you want to, you know, there used to be in the 80s this thing where, you know, you were like, you know, taught to have all your emotions come up at once and you just start yelling and screaming and pounding and punching. And that is so not right. I mean, you're re-traumatizing people and they just go further into their shell. So these days, it's very important to take very small steps in awakening those trauma memories and the bodily sensations, and making sure that the person has complete control over what's going on. Otherwise, they get traumatized. And that's what one thing that music therapy can do. We're not trying to open people up. We're trying to give them very small doses of self-awareness and experience of emotional release. Let's see, what else? One of the other hallmarks of people with PTSD and complex trauma is this hypervigilance. Right? You might know people like this, or you might have it yourself, where it's really, really difficult to completely relax. Right? So people that have that sort of nervous system reaction, it really is the fight or flight nervous system reaction, your sympathetic arm of the autonomic nervous system is like always on. And these are people that have a difficult time sleeping as well. A lot of them need, you know, someone like Michael Jackson. He had complex trauma. The guy was abused as a little boy. He was forced to work. He couldn't have a normal childhood. And so here he is, 50 years old, taking, you know, anesthesia to sleep. You know, I can't imagine living like that, you know, with so much pressure on you and having all of that on top of complex trauma. And so a lot of the other people that we see in music therapy, people with addictions, mica patients, mental illness and addictions. We also have people with chronic illness. Research shows that often unresolved childhood trauma manifests itself in autoimmune diseases, fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue syndrome, arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis. These are things that are very hard to cure without working at an emotional level. And it's not that these diseases are imagined, they are absolutely diseases, but they are associated with a depleted, an overactive autonomic nervous system, which eventually depletes some of the functioning of the body-mind.
Is that continual arousal associated with some of the sexuality, or hypersexuality, or something?
Sexuality, shopping, workaholism, of course, all the other, you know, eating and smoking and drinking and sex addictions are really rampant amongst people who have been abused and traumatized. So let's see what else we have here. Okay, so last week Mary talked a little bit about the brain and what happens, the amygdala, which is in the limbic system of the brain. The emotional centers of the brain are overstimulated. And important way of healing trauma is building a bridge between the prefrontal cortex, which is the part of our brain, the executive functioning of the brain, and the more primitive part of the brain, the emotional brain, that doesn't have a lot of control. And again, music therapy techniques can be very useful in that way, and I'll go into that in a moment. Okay, so I'm gonna start with an exercise, actually. There are stages in trauma recovery, and the first stage in my practice, I'm also a psychoanalyst as well as a music therapist, so I found that in working with traumatized patients that I really needed a lot more training because so much of the work is really shows up in your relationship with the client, and you use yourself as part of the learning that the patient has in getting well. So stage one for me is always about safety, and about anybody who's doing therapy, and particularly with traumatized people. You don't want to push. You don't want to be intrusive or invasive in any way because this is a big part of their trauma. So The technique that I use that I feel is very successful is I ask clients to bring in a song that is most poignant in their life at that particular moment in time. And I've done this with children, elderly adults, people of all ages in between the two. It could be used with people with psychiatric illness, with physical illness, or whatever. The song is a mirror of the inner life. The song is a story about them. You know, nobody ever brings a song in that's their mother's favorite song, right? They bring in something that has meaning to them. And so I'm going to just play you a couple of songs, and I'm going to ask you, and I'm going to have the words up here too, so that, and that's the other thing, after I listen to a song with clients, I will ask them, is there a line in that song that's most significant for you? And that line often gives me an incredible insight into who this person is and what they're needing. So here's a song that a 16-year-old violinist brought in to me in one of her first sessions. She had chronic pain in her back. She had been to many therapists and doctors, and they all told her, it was in your head, you're crazy, there's nothing wrong with you. Now, saying that to a teenager or to anybody is traumatic, and it should never be done. So this is the song that she shared with me, and those are the words. So just take a look and see which words jump out at you. I'm not going to play the whole song, but... Now, just listening to the tone of the piece, there's something going on, right? Is really the answer to her pain, right? But anybody else have feelings about just a little bit of what you just heard? Anybody know this song? It's called Looking In, Mariah Carey, Looking In. I couldn't fit it on the PowerPoint, but so here's a girl that was in a family chamber group with her parents and siblings, kind of a Michael Jackson type story, and she was an entertainer, and she's been one since she was a little girl. And what we've realized in the therapy is that the pain in her back was basically this rage that, how can you do this to me? I want to have a life. I want to have a boyfriend. And eventually, you know, she was able to work that through in improvising on her violin, you know, playing the rage, playing the passion that she wanted to express in relationships with other people, not just in being a performer. And, you know, unfortunately, these kinds of things take their toll on families, But the mother and father didn't realize this was going on. They really didn't. And when they realized how upset their daughter was, and how deprived she felt, they were horrified. It's not that they wanted to do this to her. They just thought, oh, what fun, you're with the family and we're playing music and, you know, we're making money and isn't this great? But it wasn't great for her. And that's something that is so important. So in this stage one of the treatment with this patient, this song, you know, gave me so much more insight than her just, you know, how do teenagers talk? I'm fine. What do you want? I'm nothing. You know, I mean, they don't want to talk very much to an adult. But the song said it all. And my mirroring back to her what I heard in the song was very powerful. And that is a music therapy technique. It's called projective listening. The song being a projection of what's inside. And when the therapist mirrors that back to the client, they're starting to develop a sense of self-awareness. I didn't know I was that girl. I didn't realize what I was feeling inside, you know. And again, we don't say very much in stage one. We're really just creating a fertile environment for trust. So I don't analyze the song. I just mirror back what I'm hearing. Question?
So you said about projective listening, you find that as being able to understand what's going on, like through their song, is that how you would say it?
The song is being a projection of some aspect of the inner life of the patient or the client. So I can play you a couple. I mean, there's just so many amazing songs that we get turned on to as music therapists. I mean, songs that you want to go back to and hear over and over again. I mean, one of the songs that I never would have heard on my own, but is this one by Kurt Cobain. I mean, it's not funny. I actually went online and I looked at, you know, there was something about his suicide that I had never had the courage to do, and he died because I was so angry that the people around him didn't realize how in pain he was. But you can hear it in his music. Just a little bit of it. You can just hear it. And see if you can pick out the line that is most poignant for you in this song. And actually, the words don't make a lot of sense to me. But there's a lot of meaning in them. This is where the emotion comes in. Feelings, thoughts, what are you seeing? If this was your client, what might you learn from this song?
Well, the line "the lights out" is less dangerous to me. It's like, when it's dark and shutting out like the reality of what your actions are and to yourself as well, that, you know, your body has no meaning, other people's bodies have no meaning, and so you can do whatever you want, and because you're not really afraid of, I get, you know, just not even being afraid of death or and but also in that way not enjoying life, like not enjoying and connecting to what else is around you because you're shut off, you're in the dark, you've pushed yourself away.
Yeah, so you have a strong sense of a story being told in that particular line in the song. Yeah, and so you might say that, you know. First, I'd ask him or her, what line is really stands out for you in that song? And so they might say, you know, I feel stupid and contagious. And then, you know, well, you know, what makes you feel that way? Or tell me more, you know. And then, you know, once we get through that, I might say, well, you know, with the lights out, it's less dangerous. That really affects me. And so the client might say, well, tell me, what are you feeling? And then, you know, and then I share. And that's building relationship. I mean, we're not like a Freudian analyst where we're like, well, what do you think? And what do you feel? We are real people. We're not disclosing our own suffering necessarily, but we are reacting to what's going on within that relationship. Did you have something you wanted to say?
I just wanted to ask about other relations.
There it is. It's very much what a lot of depth-oriented music therapists are using, that model. Object relations, which has a lot to do with developing that intimacy within the therapeutic relationship. I had a guy, oh my goodness, he was a high school student. I was working in special ed. And it turned out he was the only guy in one of my groups. And so there it was, he and I. And he was very resistant. And I asked him to bring in his favorite piece of music. And so the next week he comes in by himself and he brings in this death metal piece called Mommy, I Had a Bad Day. And it's this guy who is literally screaming at the top of his lungs with music going like 190 beats per minute. And he's like, Mommy, I had a bad day! You know, and it's just like, ugh, torture. I felt like my heart was being ripped out of my body. But as a music therapist, we don't say, oh, turn that crap off. You know, we're like, this is very important information. And so, yeah, you can imagine what this guy's life was like. And so after, you know, I got through it and I said, oh my God, you know, do you ever have days like that? And he just kind of smirked. And then the next class, he brings in another death metal piece about a man who proceeded to murder all the women in his life, you know. And so there I am sitting alone with him. And I said, you know, do you live in a house with women? I mean, who are the women that you live with? And he smirked again, and then, you know, he sat there, he started literally like cutting himself in front of me, which is one of a symptom of people who have been traumatized and abused. And so the following, and I sat with him and I said, look, you know, I know that if somehow it feels good to cut yourself, but I'm not going to let you do that. And I won't let anyone ever do that to you as long as I'm around you. And so the following week, he came in and he brought Pink Floyd's Wish You Were Here, which is a totally different kind of music. So what do you, does anybody know that tune? We're just two lost souls swimming in a fishbowl year after year. Running over the same old ground until I found the same old fears. Wish you were here. So he's kind of saying, you're in my life, man. You know, we're in this together, which is pretty cool. You know, if you have someone that wants to kill all the women in his life, and then he's kind of saying to you, you know, you kind of understand me. We're two fish, we're swimming in a fishbowl together. And it's like, yeah, you're right. I'm not really that different. So that's basically the roots of creating this kind of relationship in music therapy with traumatized people. And music therapists in clinical settings use songs all the time to engage their clients. And they do sing-alongs and they do interpretation of lyrics and things like that, which not only develops a relationship between the therapist and the client, but also the group members, which is so important for them in those kinds of settings. Yeah.
If you ask someone to bring in a song, their favorite song, or mean something to them for the first session, and they bring in a piece without lyrics, how does that change things? Like, what? Because you can't exactly say, okay, like, you know, what song, what line is the most meaningful, or what line
stands out? Okay, I'll give you an example.
Thank you.
This was a song that actually had a breakthrough, or created a breakthrough for one of my clients who had been sexually abused, and it doesn't have words, but when you hear it, you get a sense of what this is about. Reactions. What are you feeling? How's your heart rate? If someone brought that in to you who had been traumatized or abused, what would you, I don't know, what's your initial reaction?
My initial reaction is how small I feel compared to the sound of what you
Interesting. Hear. That's fascinating. I would use that information. That's like countertransference. You know, all of the artwork that our clients bring in are going to affect us in some way, and those reactions often are related to the hidden experiences in our clients. So you felt very small. Possibly your client felt very, very small. Maybe they didn't, but you test it out, you know. They might agree with you, they might not. And when you hit it on the head, they tend to really trust you a little bit more. If you don't hit it on the head and you say, oh, okay, well, it affected me that way, they trust you as well because they see that you're a feeling person. You're not just a cold, faceless, or energy-less person. You know, they trust you. You're a person. You have feelings.
I had the opposite reaction. It was like gearing up to fight.
Yeah.
It was a rah-rah-rah, you know.
Yeah. See, that's the other wonderful thing about music, is that it's so subjective. There is no formula to heal people with music. In the beginning of my career, I've had doctors call me up because I was a stress expert. They would call me and they would say, what music should I play for my clients? I'm like, well, what kind of clients do you have? I don't know. They're you know, kidney patients. It's like, well, play kidney music, of course. I said, well, you have to get to know them. I don't have time for that. Just tell me what to play. And so I said, well, why don't you just try Pachelbel's Canon? He goes, okay, well, who wrote it? I'm like, Pachelbel? Yeah, you know, in other words, music therapy is a science. You really have to study it. You have to know music inside out. And you also have to know yourself inside out in order to be able to discriminate what is you and what is them. So, and that's true for all the arts therapies. You know, it's they're sciences. They're not just, oh, we'll have fun and we'll sing some songs. You know, that's having fun and singing songs. Music therapy is different. Okay, so that's stage one, creating safety, developing the therapeutic alliance. And once that's starting to feel safe and solid for you, you can move into the second stage, which has to do with the beginning stages of looking at some of the trauma memories and trauma experiences and dealing with conflict within the relationship. Because if you truly are experiencing an alignment with your client, then there are going to be reenactments in the therapeutic relationship that are going to be similar to what your client experienced with other people. And that is where the magic can happen in dealing with long-term personality kinds of issues and chronic pain or chronic illnesses or other kinds of chronic addictions and things like that. So one way that we start to work with the body in music therapy is through what we call clinical improvisation. We use instruments as a way of exploring the here and now moment, the impulse, the physicality of the body mind. And so I have with me here some instruments that we use as part of our practice in music therapy. And generally, they're instruments that are effortless to play. Like, for example, this is a rain stick. It goes on and on and on. But believe it or not, for emotionally disturbed children, this instrument is a godsend because it relaxes them. They love that sound of rain. It's soothing and comforting. In my 30 years of practice, I have never seen a kid try to hurt anyone with a rain stick. There's something, it looks like it could be like a club of some sort, but they just realize. In fact, it's so funny, when I started working with special ed, I would ask kids, where does music come from? Music comes from nature. Music comes from God. How do kids know that? They know how special music is, and no one has ever told them that. So if a kid has that awareness of music, why not use it as a way of helping them to heal and grow? Drums of all sorts. You've got different rhythms stimulating different energies within the self. And kids love to play rhythms. Other things that we have are African instruments. I don't have any of my melodic instruments in here. But here's one. This is a kid instrument that adults really love. You can really get into this. And you can sort of see the difference between instruments that bring you into the body and instruments that bring you out of the body. I like these better. And then, of course, you've got most music therapists have a guitar and a keyboard as a way of creating harmonic progressions that can hold the improvisations of a client, or not. I mean, you don't always have to have an accompaniment instrument in clinical improvisation. Sometimes we just, have two instruments. In fact, why don't we do a little demonstration? This is a clinical improvisation exercise where we're just going to be playing together. And I am going to use three things that most music therapists will do in clinical improvisation. The first is to mirror sort of what the other person is playing, but not exactly what they're playing, because that would be, you know, really weird. It's like someone just saying really weird and whatever you say, like you hate that, right? So you don't want to do that, but you want to make them know that you're really hearing them. The other is holding them. So if they're really emoting somehow through the instrument, you are creating a space to make sure that they are contained. And the other thing that we'll be doing is leading. If someone's sort of perseverating, we're going to want to try to break that up and give them another direction they could possibly go. So let me see what other instruments I can entice you with. I always think of the tambourine as kind of a joyful sort of instrument. This is a ocean drum. So does anybody feel an inclination to play one of these instruments? Okay, go for it.
I used to play the tambourine when I was in church.
Fantastic.
It's my favorite. I just...
Wait. Okay. Fascinating that music takes you directly back to that limbic system, part of the brain, the hippocampus, the place where you store your life's memories. Just like that, the power of music. Any particular memory come up for you?
No, just being in church family, every Sunday, gathering my Sunday dresses, just playing with a lot of kids.
That's pretty specific. Your Sunday dresses, you know, that definitely, I can see my closet and those little dresses I used to wear and going to church on Sunday as well. Yeah, and the music just brought that up for you. So that would be an example of creating a musical self statement. You just gave us a little window into your world. Right? And there was joy in it, and there was a sense of, I don't know, what else do people hear? Tell us your name again.
Carolina.
Tell us what you learned about Carolina from that improvisation.
Well, it was obviously something that was probably imprinted at a young age and practiced a lot because the rhythms were very sequential and there was like a call and response, kind of like you would kind of find your way back. It just seemed like something that we did a lot. So
there was a little bit of mastery in it. I agree. Yeah. And she was proud of that mastery. Mm-hmm. What else? What else did we hear or see? What's that?
I think it's leads to a very healthy foundation of development because you transcended the nervousness by going deep into what you knew was there for you, that rhythm.
That's a really good point. Yeah, we got to see her coping skills and her strength in being in front of people. And that's important to know about our students, our clients, our friends. You know, I always tell people that they can do this and when they're looking for a mate, just have them do a little improvisation And you can really tell a lot about a person, you know, whether it's is this somebody that I really want to be married to, or just have a couple of dates and let it go at that. You really, you know, as music therapists, right, John? We always choose our mates that way. No, no, I'm teasing. No. So that's a musical set. Yes, question.
Just observational question. Okay, so definitely saw you making some rhythms, and then I saw you dancing in those rhythms. I was wondering if that ever occurs also, you know, or if that completely, like, what a therapist moving to whatever you're doing.
I'm sure that happens. Well, it's not something that I was consciously doing. I mean, what I often do is, in terms of developing the relationship, is I play with somebody. So why don't I try that with you? but you see, that you don't have to. Music therapy is mostly done with non-musicians. A lot of people don't realize that. When I used to tell people I was a music therapist, they would say, oh, you do therapy with musicians? It's like, well, yeah, I do, but not primarily. I mean, I also work with other people. So why don't you give it a try? So pick an instrument, and then we'll sit down together, and we'll just play and see what happens. You like that one, okay. So you don't need a chair then, you like to dance. All right, so what will I do? I think I'll use my voice. That was brave of you to do that. So anything, yeah. So what was it like? What was it like to play spontaneously without an agenda?
Well, I think you're right. It's definitely, it's an outward instrument. And it was interesting because it's sort of like your singing was also very, I felt very out of
it. It was out there.
Projecting out of you. So something like about the music meeting. And that stuff felt safe.
Yeah. That's the whole idea. You looked like you were having fun. Let's get some feedback and see what were people seeing in this interaction. Yeah.
I don't know, at first, like, you know, you're a little timid. You're like, oh, I don't know, you're a little resistant at first, but then, like, once you joined in and kind of, I guess, established that safe zone, and where, like, you were kind of being silly and, you know, just kind of letting loose, and then it kind of just happened, and it seemed like you just like let go of nervousness or embarrassment. Because I know if I would do that, I'd feel like, oh. But it made it very like inviting and just like do what you want. There's no judgment there.
Yeah. Good. Thank you. Anybody else?
I like the exploration of it, but in the very beginning, like you were just going at this very fast pace because that was making the noise. And then since you were doing all sorts of scales, and sometimes, you know, it was sort of, it wasn't harmonious, it was, some of it was a little off sounding, you know, atonal, whatever. And so then you started to like slow down. And so it was like safety and exploration that it was okay to, like the process was okay. It wasn't like the actual creation, but getting there and what is getting there. Like you're just kind of like moving around. And so like having fun within, not having there to be like a set musical score, basically, or rhythm.
That's exactly right. I mean, think about it. If you're working with somebody who has been traumatized, abused, made to feel unsafe, then play has a lot to do with perfection or doing it right or not making a mistake because then I'll get hit or I'll get in trouble or whatever. And so and the music therapist just sort of models that this is just about being together. It's not about doing anything right or perfectly. And sometimes it might be the first time in a client's life that they weren't, you know, being scrutinized or graded or, you know, yelled at for something. And so it might be the beginning of a whole new level of expression. And once that expression starts to open up, that's when a lot of the trauma memories and emotions can be externalized and healed. I'm just thinking about one of my clients was a professional musician. She was actually a Grammy Award winning musician, and she was so, and she was an improviser, but she was so frozen in the way that she performed that her improvisations had to be perfect, believe it or not, like if you can imagine that. And when I would sit down at the piano to play with her, she would just, she couldn't let go. She just didn't want anything ever to sound not perfect. And so one day we were talking about her father, and I said, well, you know, I'd really like to know your father more. Well, I mean, if you could play him on the piano, what would it sound like? She's like, what? How can I play my father on the piano? I said, well, he has a sound, doesn't he? He has a melody, he has a harmony. And I'm like, yeah, you know, you're right. So that was her breakthrough. She took off the mask and she was able to play her father, like, I'll just pretend, you know, so the father might have been like, you know, and she just, woo. She let something come out that she never knew was in there. It was a whole other level of expression. And the look on her face, like, oh my God. It's like having had that expressive capacity in yourself locked up for 35 years. And finally, there's an opening. And that's often what music therapy can do for people. And again, this is a stage two for me in treatment. You know, people need to be ready to have that realization. And so she went from there to, you know, having some really horrible memories coming up of childhood abuse and things like that. So. But again, it came out in the play, in the improvisation. And my gosh, we only have, what, 5 minutes left or so? Okay, so I guess I better ask if there are any questions. Yeah.
Do you ever use the Tibetan singing bowl?
Oh, I do.
Okay, because I was wondering, because that always is like so nice. Like, I always feel so relaxed.
Yeah, thanks for mentioning that, because one of the important things about music therapy, it's not all about opening people up. It's about creating ways to relax, you know, because if you're hypervigilant, you've got to find ways of calming down the nervous system. And what I find with the singing bowls is almost every time I do it or anyone that I'm working with does it, they sigh. We hold our breath all the time, particularly traumatized people, people that are hypervigilant. They breathe in and they don't breathe out. And then suddenly you hear, So, you know, if you notice clients like that, or friends or relatives, you probably would get really good effects giving them a singing bowl or Tibetan tinkshas, their little bells that you click together, or other kinds of gongs and things like that, or those little, you know, there's like a little thing with the three bars on them, and they each have this beautiful little tone. The vibration from those kinds of instruments are very soothing. And that's a very important part of music therapy for trauma, is to teach your clients ways of coping with their anxiety. So doing breathing exercises along with music. Like, for example, I'll have people breathing in rhythm to like let it be, you know? So breathing in, when I find myself in times of trouble, out. Mother Mary comes to me, in. Speaking words of wisdom, out. Let it be. You know, learning that your breath can be rhythmic. We don't have to breathe in, hold our breath, or breathe out and not breathe in again. You know what I'm saying? That's one of the patterns that happens in traumatized people. They do not have a regular breath rhythm. Don't you find that a lot in your clients? And music might be the only way. I mean, music naturally creates rhythm in the body-mind. Right? Brain waves become coherent, breathing patterns become coherent, blood pressure becomes stabilized, right? So all of these things naturally come into balance with music, but if you bring that to your client's attention, then they can consciously use music to stabilize their breathing, particularly when they're scared. You know, self-care is absolutely essential for people who have been traumatized. And I always think about like Freud doing all his analysis with his patients, that a lot of them were terribly traumatized, but he never gave them any tools to take home with them. So they kept coming back for years and years and years and years. You know, but these days, we therapists, we want to give our clients things that they can use at home to continue the therapy process and not just become dependent on you as a therapist. So, thanks for bringing that up. Any other questions?
Yeah. How do you do musical therapy with people who have no, can't carry a tune, have no rhythm, just don't hear notes? I mean, there are people who...
We do it every day. Everybody has what I call, my title of my book is called Essential Musical Intelligence. We are all born with musical intelligence. It's one of the eight intelligences that Howard Gardner talks about in his book of Understanding Human Nature. And so people can say, I can't carry a tune, probably because somebody told them that. No one would say that about themselves. Because everyone sings, that's normal, you know? So yeah, I had one patient that said no to me, and he was a cancer patient, and he was so bombarded with people coming in and out of his room all day long. And I came in happy, smiling with my instruments, and he's like, no, get out. And I was like, okay, you got it, you know? But other than that guy, with thousands of people I've worked with, no one has ever not been able to improvise or to sing or whatever. Really, you too can be a music therapy client.
I just want to bring it back to attachment because that's a big deal thing. So I was just wondering like what, someone does have disorganized attachment from his child. Do you see those patterns changing with them? Because I know there's this idea that's like,
You know, it's an old pattern, so it can take time to change. But when the therapeutic relationship is strong, you're creating a new template. Mm-hmm. that can then begin to manifest in other relationships. You know, that's the power of this psychoanalytic or psychodynamic music therapy, is kind of ongoing one-on-one therapy can change those early attachment issues. But it's not quick. Like, I'll give you an example. I had a woman with post-traumatic stress who was suicidal. She was bulimic. She was an artist. Had, you know, a lot of no healthy attachment. And it took her 5 years to get to the point where she was ready to be with a guy that she was dating, and they got married, and now she has children. She's very successful. And, you know, and it was torture for her. It was hard work. And hard work for me. You know, when you're working with trauma, you really are very much in it. But it's worth it, because you really can change. But, you know, it's not a quick fix. So, and unfortunately, insurance companies expect, all right, 12 sessions. That's all we can afford, and you should be done with your PTSD in those 12 sessions.
Can you talk about the initials?
Post-traumatic stress disorder?
No, the initials after your...
Oh, yeah. So LP is licensed psychoanalyst, and LCAT is licensed creative arts therapist, and MT means board certified music therapist. So, yeah, I'm a credentialed person. You can trust me. Signing off. Thank you for being a great honor.